So, let's have a look at how arches got evolved till date. Before going into the deep history, what is an arch? An arch is a caved symmetrical structure spanning an opening and typically supporting the weight of a bridge, roof, or wall above it. So, starting with natural arches. Natural arches commonly formed were inland cliffs, coastal cliffs, finso stacks are subject to erosion from the sea, rivers, or weathering. There are three types of natural arches: coastline arches, water eroded arches, and weather eroded arches. All these are formed as a result of cave erosion. How did arches become a part of architecture? Yes, it is through lintel doorways. One of the things our early ancestors wanted to do was to build structures for housing, walls for protection, and special buildings for religion. But this lintel doorways faced a huge problem, which is the main reason why arches have got evolved to this extent till date. The problem with stone pillars topped with a flat lintel is that it cannot bear much weight. As a result, the lintel beam will be under high compression, which obviously will lead to the breakage of the whole structure. Egeoblalmer Temple in ancient Ur has one of the oldest arches in the world. Here, we have a classic arch executed in mud brick. Three sun-dried mud brick arches of Teldan, spanning the gateway's passageway, are the world's oldest non-complete and freestanding monumental true arches made of this material. All its three arches were soundly constructed in three concentric radial crosses of mud brick. Coming into corbel arches. A corbel arch is constructed by offsetting successive courses of stone at the spring line of the walls so that they project towards archway center from each supporting side until the courses meet at the apex of the archway. Coming into circular arches. Circular arch is an arch whose intradose takes the form of a segment of a circle. This type of arch, the center lies exactly on the springing line. Talking about segmental arch, it is a type of arch with a circular arc of less than 180 degrees. It is sometimes also called as scheme arch. The segmental arch is one of the strongest arches because of its ability to resist thrust. Into rampant arch. It is a type of arch whose start in walls or buttresses are located at different levels, often with a considerable difference in height. Geometric rules have prevailed over scientific theories for a very long time in the study of arches and walls. A true scientific formulation took place during 19th and 18th centuries. It was after this pointed arches started to take form. Coming into lancet arches. A lancet arch is a window with a pointed arch. This was an attempt to use light as a building material, which allowed a lot more light to enter into the building. These are considered somewhat Gothic and often have stained glass or other designs on them. And then came the equilateral arches. It is an arch described by two circular curves intersecting at the peak of the arch, each curve having a chord equal to the span. coming into shouldered flat arch or jack arch. Jack arch is a structural element used in masonry construction and provides support at the openings in the masonry. These arches look like shoulders and are hence named so. And then came the trefoil arch or trefoil cusped arch. It is an arch incorporating the shape or outline of a trefoil tree overlapping rings. It has been widely used for its symbolic significance in Christian architecture. And then jammed the horseshoe arch. It is also called the Moorish arch and the keyhole arch. It is the emblematic arch of Moorish architecture. Horseshoe arches can take form as rounded, pointed or lobed. Tree-centered arch. It is an arch whose inner curved surfaces is struck from three centers, resulting in a shape approximating one half of an ellipse. This arch style is a strong structure and is often found in bridges and aqueducts. Talking about elliptical arches, it is an arch having the shape of half an ellipse. In its construction, the ellipse is often approximated by three adjoining circular arcs. And then came the OG arch. This type of arch is formed by joining two S-shaped curves. An OG arch uses two of these curves and links them at the top, where they meet in a point. We also have a reverse OG arch. Here, instead of using two S-shaped curves, it uses two opposing S-shaped curves. Soon came the Tudor arch. It was especially used for doorways, but it gives a wide opening without taking too much space above, compared to a more pointed Gothic arch. In this case, it can be even flatter than usual and may not be four-centered in terms of geometry, with some of the upper edges effectively being straight. And then came the catenary arch. It is a type of architectural arch that follows an inverted catenary curve. The catenary curve has been employed in buildings since ancient times. It forms an underlying principle to the overall system of walls and buttresses in stone-vaulted Gothic cathedrals and in Renaissance domes. We also have parabolic arch. It is an arch in the shape of a parabola. In these structures, their curve represents an efficient method of load and so can be found in bridges and in architecture in a variety of forms. So, that is all about how arches got evolved throughout these years. Thank you.